Thank you, Saila. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Okay. So two underlying themes in this webinar. One, why the delay in trial? And two, why do under trials not get bail under UAPA? And so I'll focus this address on these two underlying themes by explaining why that is happening under UAPA and what is this regime under the UAPA which allows for trials to not take off and which allows under trial prisoners to remain in prison because of the stringency of the provisions that are available under the UAPA. Now there are two provisions. One is section 43D of the UAPA, which allows for a change in general law. Now, under general law, if a person is arrested, the theme is that within 24 hours, the investigation should be completed. If not completed, the person should be produced before a magistrate, and the magistrate has the power to remand such person for 15 days at a time, but not more than 60 or 90 days, depending upon the gravity of the offense. So for some offenses, which is punishable less than 10 years, the upper limit is 60 days, and for all other offenses, 90 days. So even a murder suspect, the charge sheet must be filed within 90 days. And if not filed within 90 days, the accused is entitled to statutory bail. Now, under UAPA, and it's very interesting how this has changed over a period of time. In 1898, when the Code of Criminal Procedure first came, the investigations were supposed to be completed within 24 hours, if not completed within 24 hours, within 15 days. In the 1973 amendment to the Code of Criminal Procedure, this got extended. The 15-day period got extended to a maximum of 60 days. Another amendment came in 1978, where 60 days was not found sufficient, and so the 60 and 90-day regime came into place. What does the UAPA do? The UAPA says that individual remands will be of periods of 30 days each. That means that the investigating agency can keep you at one stretch for 30 days each. And the maximum period of investigation can go up to 180 days. So from 90 days, you've now increased it to 180 days. And this is a provision which should be an exceptional provision. And yet it has now been normalized. It has become the norm. It has become routinized. So while courts must insist that general law must prevail and within 90 days, the charge sheet should be filed, it is now normal and routine for investigating agencies to move applications under Section 43D2 proviso for extension of the period of investigation from 90 to 180 days. And this is normally allowed instead of being exceptionally allowed. And why is that so? Because of the of what has been created around the Act, the UAPA Act. Now, that alone is not the mischief. What investigative agencies have now learned to do is that while they may extend the remand of one person up to 180 days, they arrest another person in the middle of that. And when they arrest another person in the middle of that, that investigation has another 180 days and so on and so forth. Which is why, to answer the question which many have been asking, why has the trial not taken off in this case? The simple answer is because investigation is still going on. They're arresting more and more people. And based on that arrest, they get literally an additional 180 days for every person that they're arresting. And so the trial of the first person who was arrested, although their charge sheets have been filed, will be delayed because the prosecution says we are still investigating the case. So this is where, this is the detail where the state gets to extend the period of detention in a circuitous way and get, in this case, 2 years' time, and yet the people arrested have not been able to argue their case on charge, which is the first threshold where the court reviews the material and against an accused person and decides whether to proceed further or not. So this really is one of the sections which has been abused to such an extent that investigating agencies have been able to prolong investigations, and it is unfortunate that courts routinely allow their application for extension of investigation. And when we challenge those applications in superior courts, we have now been told that the law, which was earlier laid down by the Supreme Court in Hitendra Vishnu Thakur's case, has been has literally been overruled. And now the latest judgment of the Delhi High Court in Sharjeel Imam's case says that an accused person will be informed of the application moved by the investigating agency for extension of time, but he has no right to participate in the proceedings, and he has no right to oppose the application. He has now no right to even get a copy of the prosecutor's report. Imagine what kind of regime this is. Between 0 to 90 days, the general law says that at every stage, an accused person has the right to participate, to oppose remand, and the law says that within 90 days, you should file the charge sheet. And if you don't file it, the person is released on bail. But under the UAPA, because the proviso gives them the power to investigate up to 180 days, and the switchover from 90 to 180 days is just an application supported by a report of the prosecutor saying, for these reasons, we have not been able to conclude investigation, it has become so routine that investigating agencies, just for the asking, are able to get this extension. And the accused person, who should be central to the stage, has been pushed, and I use this term once in court, has been made part of the furniture of the courtroom, because his views are not sought as to why the investigation must go on for 180 days and why the investigating agency has not been able to complete investigations expeditiously. So this is why trials do not take off. And this is where the mischief of the act comes into full play. The other provision, and a lot of you have spoken about the fact that the UAPA does not allow for bails. And that is because section 43D5 makes it almost impossible for a person to get bail if charged under UAPA offenses. And why is that? Because the onus has shifted. Now, under general law, if you were to look at general law, where a person is not charged under UAPA, the court just has to see whether there are reasonable grounds for believing that the accused has committed an offense. So it's a very different kind of yardstick before bail is granted or refused. Whereas under UAPA, the shift is that the court will see whether the accused has been able to dispel the reasons stated by the investigating agency and whether a prima facie case exists against the accused. It's not reasonable grounds to believe whether the accusation is true or not, but whether a prima facie case exists against the accused or not, which is a very low threshold. And also the entire onus has shifted from the prosecution to the accused. In fact, in a recent judgment of the Supreme Court, where the Delhi High Court granted bail to an accused person, it was called NIA versus Zahoor Ahmed Shah Vatali, the Supreme Court says a high burden has been placed on the accused to demonstrate that the prosecution has not been able to show that there exists reasonable grounds to show that the accusation against him is prima facie true. Look at the perversity of the situation. It is for the accused to demonstrate that there are no reasonable grounds to believe that the prosecution has a prima facie case against him. How these provisions are allowed to pass this test of constitutionality amazes me. But not only has it passed the test of constitutionality, it appears courts are endorsing the position of prosecuting agencies while making these findings in judgments. So this is the reason why, firstly, trials are delayed, And secondly, bails are not granted. Now, if the court finds, now, what is the state? I mean, again, I'm going into legal jargon, but it is only when charges are framed can a court say that there is a prima facie case against an accused or not. Now, that also means that if charges are framed under UAPA, an accused has absolutely no way of getting bail because the threshold is only prima facie case. So these are the reasons why bails are not granted and the accused continues to remain in almost permanent incarceration till such time that the evidence in the case is not completed, which doesn't happen with any sense of urgency. And that's why trials take so long. And that's why under trial prisoners remain in prison for such a long period of time. Now, aside from these two really big, big complications that this act throws up, what is also a matter of a grave concern is the usage of very, very loose language to fix accountability and to fix the crime on an individual. So you have usage of terms like frontal organizations, formations. We don't; these are not defined under the Act. And so what happens really is because these terms are so vague and because the legislation itself is so vague, it should have not crossed the test of constitutionality, but indeed it has. So is it not time for us to ask the following questions? The UAPA is running counter to the established canons of jurisprudence. Why is it allowed to exist on our statute books? The UAPA serves as a reminder that we are far, far away from the concept of constitutional morality and transformative constitution that the Supreme Court enunciated in the recent Naftej Johar judgment. Why are we not concerned about it? The UAPA takes us into the dark, shadowy world of banned organizations and fronts of banned organizations with its nebulous memberships, ambiguous associations, all based on loose language and loosely constructed enigmatic definitions that are open-ended, vague, and wholly unclear. So is there not a case to make that this act is misused, the long periods of incarceration of under trials, often without any credible or cogent evidence? And is this not a reality that we need to address? This act is simply a camouflage to keep the dissenter away for as long as the trial lasts, because given its track record, the process is really the punishment. Now, long back, Justice H.R. Khanna in the ADM Jabalpur case had said that the history of personal liberty we must bear in mind is largely the history of insistence upon procedure. As a lawyer, I find this deeply, deeply distressing, that every procedural safeguard that the Constitution of India guarantees to an individual citizen and which the Code of Criminal Procedure, which is the general law, has guaranteed to accused persons has been thrown away in this act, and we don't seem to be overtly concerned about it. Thank you.